Now back to the show. This is The Law Show on CL 650.
And welcome back to The Law Show on CL 650. We're talking about family law, the breakup of relationships and marriages. We have from McQuarrie LLP. See, it sounds like you're an Italian firm now. Leah Donaldson and David Halkett. Great that you're with us. I want to get into the dirty side of this, and that's the money. Not just the clients. I guess it all is the client's money, but it's an expensive thing to go through. I'm looking at the Canadian Lawyers 2011 Legal Fees Survey, and this to me sounds a little light. It says an uncontested divorce ranges from $1,006 to $2,547, the average being $1,353. That seems low to me. A contested divorce, meanwhile, can cost anywhere from $7,200 to $74,000, with the average being $12,875. So do those numbers seem low to you?
Well, it depends if they're counting in tax and disbursements or if they're just counting the
Well, there's other fees here. There's another one that goes on to say application, $157, mm-hmm. search the registry, process the server, motion of judgment, court clerk filing, certification of a certificate of divorce are all extra fees, right?
Yeah. So when for uncontested divorces, when there's no children, it's relatively straightforward. So the fees are lower, but of course there's the disbursements on top. When it comes to a contested situation, again, it can be as little as a separation agreement if they've all agreed of like $5,000, or as someone said, it can be like half your house, depending on how much you fight.
So with this average being $12,875,
that's probably a little low for a contested.
I think that's low.
Yeah, because it would seem to me that if you have any contested applications, you're probably looking at $7,000 to $8,000 just for the application itself.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, so give me a breakdown of how many people come in with an uncontested divorce, straight to the point, doesn't cost much, and how many people come in with a contested divorce? What are the percentages, do you think?
Certainly, I would say at least at the beginning, 80% are contested. It's very rarely that I get someone come in without any other issues and it's purely a divorce.
Unless it's been like for just a few months or something like
that. Yeah, or they're young and have no assets, no children, and it's just like, look, we don't want to be together anymore. There's nothing to divide and divorce. A lot of them turn into an uncontested situation down the road. You've resolved all the other issues and all that's left is ending the legal marriage. But it's 80% come in with some other issue above and beyond.
Typically, Leah, what are those sort of top three issues when people are contesting their divorce?
I would say, so in order to get a divorce, if you have children, mm-hmm. you have to have resolved the child support issue. So I would say often it's parenting issues. So dividing parenting time between the two parents. I would say spousal support is a large area of contested issues. And the division of assets. So how are you going to divide up the house or the investments, things like that.
The stuff you would kind of think would be the top three, right?
Yeah, most cases that Lee and I will get division of assets, some support issues, maybe a parenting time issue, and then child support and spousal. They'll be all thrown in there.
And how often do people really dig in? So you're saying some people come around and realize, well, I'm just fighting for the sake of fighting, and it's just eating up all of our money. But what's the percentage of people that really dig in and say, I'm taking this all the way?
It varies widely, but I would say at the beginning, probably 2/3 really have their positions entrenched, and it's only because they're still angry over the separation. Once the anger goes away, then they're more willing to sit down and resolve it. So that eases over time. It's rare, you're always going to have the high conflict people that, 10% will want to fight for everything. They tend to run out of money and end up fighting on their own just because they fought over, a pillowcase, as a silly
What's
example.
The most absurd thing you've had people fight over?
This wasn't my personal case, but another lawyer in the firm told me that there was a file where people were fighting over a piece of wood that was custom designed to fit next to their air conditioning unit in their window.
Really?
Yeah.
Yes.
They fought over that.
They fought over that. I believe there was two court applications as a result of that piece of wood.
So couldn't they have, for that cost, just had a new one made and have two of them?
More than one made.
Oh, yeah. They could have had five of them made, probably. Yeah, I've had them fight over probably a tea server. Like, there was a little bit of money in it, but not a lot, not worth it. Sentimental value.
Sentimental. So that is unusual, but we do see people, fight over things that have sort of things that were inherited. Mm-hmm. So family things heirlooms.
Things that came into the marriage.
Yes.
Like I tend to tell my clients, look, don't pay me to divide your household goods. Figure it out between you. You know, make a list between the two of you, and then there may be 200 items in the home. You only disagree on 10 of them. Then flip a coin and divide it.
I remember when Mick Jagger was getting divorced from Jerry Hall. I know, you remember her name. Jerry Hall, they had a point system. And, you know, they would say between 1 and 100, mm-hmm. how important is this to you? So maybe for Mick, it was his flat in London would be 100 points. And her, it might have been the house in the south. We're talking big numbers here. Yep. Mm-hmm. The house in the south of France or whatever it was. And then they came out with this. And when you got to half the points going to one and half the points going to the other, mm-hmm. then it was pretty straightforward.
The only downside with that is I know some of my cases, they'd put the top point value on everything. That was the most important.
You have to, I guess, go into it.
Be realistic.
Be realistic about it. Because what's important, like you said, if it's an heirloom from your grandma, that really should kind of stay with you versus, but people are spiteful, right?
Well, the matters I hate the most, and I haven't had one in, like, say, the last 5 to 6 years, but someone who says, I want that just because I know my spouse wants it. Mm. And it was given to them by, like, a grandparent or something. It's like, we use it together. It's like, yeah, but come on. Mm-hmm. Like, be realistic. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't be silly about it. And I think sometimes Lee and I have the right approach in that we will tell our clients that we don't just tell them what they want to hear. We tell them what they have to hear.
Mm-hmm. Now, that's what I was getting at. So a typical divorce takes over a year, right?
Oh, yeah, at least, yeah.
So, Leah, how do you see your clients soften from the first meeting where they're angry, there's tears and tissues and all that kind of stuff, to a year later, they transform a bit, don't they?
They do. I would say I see it in two ways. The first way is the bills. So they start paying some legal fees.
Yes.
They start realizing that, okay, you know, as their emotions subside and, you know, the legal fees are increasing, they're realizing that maybe things aren't, you know, worth that fight. And then also, I think going through the process, often we'll have a mediation, and it doesn't even have to be a formal mediation with a mediator there. It can be what we call a four-way meeting with the other party and their lawyer come. And often they want to say certain things to the other party, or they need to hear certain things from the other party. And I see some growth going on in that respect as well.
Mm-hmm.
So that helps soften, because they sometimes will get something that they need from them in that mediated context that they can't get in litigation.
And what I try to do is trying to put myself in the other side's shoes when I'm giving the advice. And I tell my client, look, what do you think that your spouse is thinking? What do you think their position is? Because until we can figure out what the other side's coming from, we can't really figure out a good solution for everyone. Mm-hmm. Because the best mediated solution is where both, neither party's happy.
Yeah.
You know, if one comes out saying that how happy they are, you figure you either caved or you got a bad deal. So if both parties leave a little bit upset, that's probably a good thing.
Well, that's a great way to end it. Thank you very much. I think that's a good way to sort of finish off our first family law show in a while. It's been about a month since we've seen you, right?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, it's always great to see you. David Halkett and Leah Donaldson from McQuarrie LLP at the Surrey Central SkyTrain Station.
Yeah, in Central City, yeah.
Put all of that together.
Yeah.
Good luck. All right, thank you very much for your time, and we'll have you back again. I'm Zach Spencer. This is The Law Show, and you're listening to CL 650.